Namaskar, welcome to the third session on two-dimensional finite element analysis. My name is Sudhashil Ghosh. I am from the Department of Civil Engineering, Faculty of Engineering and Technology, MGM University, Aurangabad. As I had told you earlier, that in these particular series of lectures, we will be talking about triangular element formulation, theory of elasticity, constant strain triangles for plane stress and strain analysis, and then we'll be ending up with solving a numerical problem. So in this particular lecture, this is the third in the series, we'll be talking about constant strain triangles for plane stress analysis and strain analysis. So we'll have a brief recall of the whole thing. We are recalling that for a triangular element with thickness t, the known vertices x1, y1, x2, y2 and x3, y3, these are the known vertices here, and area is A, and with values of the field variable here is phi xy. I have introduced to you the field variable earlier also, phi xy, and the values of the field variable at x1, y1 is say phi1, and x2, y2 is phi2, x3, y3 is phi3. And this is what the values of the field variable are, and these are the vertices, right? So as a result, the expression, we have derived that expression in the first lecture. Go to the first lecture if you want to just refresh yourself. But we have derived that expression that phi f as a function of x and y can be written as n1 is a function of x and y into phi1, n2 into phi2, and n3 into phi3. The shape functions that we have also derived this one. Go to the first lecture if you want to recall. The shape functions are like these, 1 upon 2a, a1 plus b1x plus c1y, and similarly n2 and n3. And we have also, you know, written the partial derivatives of these expressions. They are written here on the screen. So what happens is, at the vertices of the triangle, supposing that this particular element, the small element that we are talking about, this is the triangle with known vertices, there will be displacements in the x direction and the y direction. Alright, so displacements in the x direction are written as u, displacements in the y direction are written as v, but both these displacements will be the function of x and y variable. This is what I am saying, and as a result, both u and v are field variables. So u is one field variable, v is one field variable, and we have already described these notations. So n1 into u1 plus n2 into ut plus n3 into u3, and n1 v1, n2 v2 and n3 v3. So again, u1, u2 and u3 are the values, known values. V1, v2, v3 are also the same known values, and we will be able to write this in the matrix formulation as, you know, uxy, vxy is the vertical matrix. This vertical matrix is written as the U matrix, and then we will get this horizontal matrix. You see this horizontal one, this is n1, 0, n2, 0, n3, 0, on 0, n1, 0, n2, 0, n3, and this particular horizontal matrix is written as n again, and then there is the constant displacement matrix, which is u1, v1, u2, v2, u3, v3. We will be able to write this in a very simple manner, with just simple algebraic manipulation of the entire system, and we will be able to write this in the matrix format. This QE is a representation of that particular vertical matrix, which is U1, V1, U2, V2, U3, V3. Okay. Now, right. So now we are going into the finite element formulation. Okay. So the partial derivatives, you have seen that the expressions for u and v are like this, and therefore, since both are functions of x and y, we are able to find out partial derivatives with respect to x and with respect to y for both these variables, all right, for both these functions. So since we are going to do that, we can have ux, vy, uy, vx and all that. So I have specifically on purpose written it like this. You could have argued that why not ux, uy and then vx and vy, but there is a specific reason which will become clear in the next slide. But you see, first of all, we are going to derive, or rather find or differentiate u partially with respect to x, and we'll get this expression. Differentiate v partially with respect to y, which we'll get this expression. And in addition, we are getting that del u by del y, all that blue red colored, you know, the red colored. So del u by del y, we have got this expression. Del v by del x, we have got this expression. We are going to add these expressions, all right, both of them. So now, incidentally, if you if you refer to the second lecture, you will find out that del u by del x is nothing but the strain in the x direction. Del v by del y is the strain in the y direction. And then you see del u by del y and del v by del x. If you just add them up, this will become the shear strain in the xy plane. So remember, since we have got these derivatives, we have been able to calculate this matrix. This is again the matrix representation of the same thing which we have done earlier. So we have got epsilon x, epsilon y, and gamma xy. So this is the strain in the x direction, strain in the y direction, and gamma xy is the shear strain. So as a result, I will be able to write this particular expression, and as a result, again, we will be able to derive this matrix. And using the values from the previous calculations, you can, you know, see the previous slides, go back to the previous slides and see. And using the values of the previous expressions, so let us see those previous values. Again, I have written these values here. You can see these values here. And using these values, we will be able to write this particular matrix representation, where there is a strain matrix, there is this constant matrix. I have already covered this in the first lecture, that all the values like B1, B2, B3, Z1, C2, C3, C1, B1, B2, C3 and all that, these values are constants. U1, V1, U2, V2, U3, V3, these are all constants. As a result, the strain matrix, which is this epsilon x, epsilon y, gamma xy, this strain matrix is a constant value. So why I'm saying constant strain triangle? Please understand that this particular matrix, epsilon x, epsilon y, gamma xy, this is a constant value matrix. Alright? So this can be written as a shorter format. So this is how the shorter format looks like. And as a shorter format, epsilon is basically that vertical epsilon x, epsilon y, gamma xy. The B matrix, which is that horizontal matrix, you can see B1, B2, B3, C1, C2, C3, all constant terms. And we have got this vertical matrix, which is the basically displacement matrix. Alright, so these are known displacements. U and V represent the displacement variables. U1, V1, U2, V2, U3, V3, they're all known values. And with respect to these known values, I have got this displacement matrix, which is QE. This is the element displacement matrix, this QE. So the strain vector, which is epsilon x, epsilon y, and that gamma xy, this is strain vector. That's a constant one. So as a result, if I am trying to calculate the stress, okay, now in the second lecture we have derived the stress thing. So we have written that the sigma is equal to d into epsilon, right? We have already written that. This is again, we have done this derivation in the second one. Please go to the second video. We have seen that sigma is equal to d into epsilon. Now epsilon is a constant vector, all right? Then d is again a constant matrix. As a result, my stress also is a constant. So here we have got stress. This sigma is equal to d matrix into b matrix into QE matrix, all right? So this is what we have got, the strain, the stress vector. Okay. Now, we are going to use the energy method formulation for this particular method. So, first of all, let us understand what is this, deriving the element equations. We have externally applied forces. Now, externally applied forces can be three things. Number one, they can be forces at the nodes. All right. Number two, they can be forces as in the terms of, so the forces at the nodes are known as the element nodal forces. The forces can be weight densities, the uniformly distributed loads. Okay, so there these weight densities, the weight densities are per unit volume, and there could be surface traction also. The this thing is per unit surface area. So we have got weight density, we have got surface traction, and we have got element nodal force. The calculations will be done separately for each of this. Please understand this. So in the energy method, what we have is this phi p, okay, represents the potential energy. The potential energy is given as like this. So this is half into sigma transpose into epsilon and dv. This is the integration is done over the entire volume. Remember that we are understanding, we are assuming, we in the first lecture we have assumed that this particular triangular element has a small thickness t. So that's why we are dealing with the volume. This is not zero thickness, all right? So we are doing a volume integration here, sigma t, sigma transpose, the transpose of the sigma matrix. And then if you want to recall, the sigma matrix is denoted as like, so if I have to transpose this, remember that what will it result in? It will result in, if I transpose sigma, I will get QE transpose into B transpose into D transpose. Now D happens to be a symmetric matrix, so D transpose equal to D. So don't get, you know, shocked that what is happening. Okay. So we are getting this these equation here, and in this particular thing, this KE becomes B transpose into D matrix, which is again a symmetric matrix, into B, and this is in dV. So this is an integration. B matrix is a constant matrix, remember. D matrix is a constant matrix, remember, again here. And okay, so this is basically a constant matrix together. And then we have got the force vector. The force vector is a summation of, remember, we have talked about three types of forces. We have got talked about surface traction, we have talked about uniformly distributed loads, and we have talked about nodal loads. So the blue color represents the nodal loads. The red color represents the forces which have weight densities, that is per unit area, per unit volume. And then we have got the surface traction, which is per unit area. So red one is per unit volume. The blue one represents the nodal ones, and the green and the other one which is available here, NTT, that one is the represents the surface traction. So as a result, what I'm going to do is I'm going down here. So if I try to minimize, remember that any system under forces will try to come in an equilibrium state. So we have to minimize this potential energy. Minimum potential energy is the state of equilibrium. So if I'm trying to minimize this, what we get is like this. Okay, so we get the force vector as a product of K, the stiffness matrix, and the displacement matrix. That is what it is. Now in the previous slide, we had said that this K is B transpose into D into V, and all these are constant. So now we have calculated. What we have calculated? We have calculated the area of the triangle, area of the triangle we have known. We have also assumed that the thickness of the triangle is T. So the volume of the triangle is A into T, correct? Agree? Now in this particular integration, we see that B is a constant matrix, D is a constant matrix, and a B again is a constant matrix. So therefore this is constant, is outside the integration. So we are only integrating the volume, and we are getting the volume. So volume is A into T. This is what we will get, right? So now we are going to calculate the body forces. Now these body forces are nothing but this weight per unit volume, the uniformly distributed loads. So this NTX dV, that is what I am interested in, that is what I am trying to calculate. Now N matrix we have already defined. This is N1, 0, N2, 0, N3, 0, and then N again 0, N1, 0, N2, 0, N3. This is the N matrix, and my this body forces, you know, represented by X, is XB per YB. And this is in the X direction and the Y direction, the components are there, and the units are weight per unit volume. So now the load per unit volume, thickness is assumed to be constant, and as a result, if I try to compute this, now look at the format of N. N is like this, N10, N20, N30, 0, N1, 0, N2, 0, N3. So if I do the transpose of this, so we will get N1, 0, 0, N1 and all that. And then we have got this weight vector, this load vector we have got. This is X. Now X is in the form of XB, YB. And we have got the volume, that is T into DA. So T is constant, XB, YB is given to us. And then N1, 0, 0, N1, this is dependent upon X and Y. So therefore, we will take this t out, and we are going to try to integrate this n1 xb over the entire area. So as a result, we just do one computation, we'll transfer the entire computation into the. So this is how it is. So we'll do one computation. The first one we'll see here, n1 xb da, that is what we are trying to do, n1 xb da here. And if I try to do this computation, we will find that it is xb into 80 into 3, 80 divided by 3. So this is 1/3 of xb into a into t. This is what the computation goes on like this. And as a result, we will be able to see that this entire computation, you go to this matrix, this entire computation, because of this particular sample integration here, we will be getting this matrix. So which basically means, if xb and yb are uniformly distributed loads per unit volume, the nodes of the element, the triangular element, shares 1/3 of the body force. So if xb is the horizontal component, is the x component, so it will be the distributed in each of the nodes as xb by 3, xb by 3, xb by 3. And again, yb is the y component, so it will be yb by 3, yb by 3, yb by 3. This is how it will be happening. And for the element surface forces, which is surface traction, we have to find out this integral. All right, now we have to now assemble the entire elements of the discretized domain. Remember, what is discretized domain? We have got a continuous surface, okay, the continuous surface. This continuous surface is assumed to be composed of triangles. We have to solve each of these triangles. We have to supply boundary conditions. That is what we do in solving differential equations. We have to supply geometric boundary conditions, and as a result, we will be able to solve this particular finite element. So we will see this in the numerical example in the next lecture. Thank you very much for attending this lecture.